Hi there everyone, and I welcome you back to Tuesday for another messy bedroom based Tuesday. Yet again, I'm knackered, I'm always knackered. Something probably needs to change therefore, doesn't it? But I'm always knackered. I've had the most insert expletive here. Tiring, knackering, stressful day. But I'm back and I'm talking to you guys, so that's a good thing. You're brightening up my day. This week's questions are very good, and one of them is really exciting and incredibly fun. The other is important. They're set by Jenny. And question one is, what are three things you feel everyone who is just starting transition should know? Now for this, I don't want to act like I'm the authority. I don't want to say this, this and this are the vital things, more important than anything else. I can look back upon my transition and tell you things that I feel maybe I could have used knowing. So that's what I'm going to do. Chief of among these things is I wish I could have been there to tell myself that time was my friend once I'd started transitioning, that not everything is going to happen immediately, be that physical development and changes, be that social anxiety, social stuff improving as a consequence of not hiding things, as a consequence of actually having transitioned. So I've got an itchy nose. These things took far longer to develop because I had to develop. I had to go through a puberty, and if I could have told myself, just let them happen, that would have been so helpful to me, and to embrace that development and that time, because it's taken years and years and years, and both physical and social and psychological development has occurred over that time so much. So there you go. You're going through puberty. Give yourself space and time. The second one is, however you can. Now, I'm not saying that it's impossible to transition successfully without this, because it is possible to without this. But try to gather around you as much support as you can. I know that's like, well, duh. But compassionate, open-minded, caring people around you, be they work colleagues or family or a partner or anyone or friends or people you know on the internet, and value them, lean on them if you need to. Knowing I had that love behind me, supported me, and made difficult times easier, and made making the step to coming out and transitioning entirely possible, because I knew there were people there for me who loved me and cared about me and still do. Lean on people if you need to. Don't be afraid to be supported. You don't have to, it's a thing you have to do, but you don't have to go through it alone. Even if it seems like you're the only one going through it, people can be there for you, and it's important to accept that. I'm not sure whether I had a problem doing that or not, but I know that having that there, as I just said, I know that having that there helped me. So that's two things. I'm going to have trouble thinking of the third thing, aren't I? Third thing is, oh God, I thought of this earlier. The third thing is, okay, no, if you're medically transitioning, take responsibility for your own medical treatment. I'm not saying do it without a doctor, because do it with a doctor. But every decision the doctor makes, every medication or surgery that's considered or you go on, take responsibility for that, know that it's your choice to do these things and the doctor is advising and helping on medical issues. Learn as much about the medical side of medically transitioning as you can, so you're aware of what's chemically happening in your body and of the things that are going on around you, be they what the medicines do or what the legal consequences are of any technical aspect of transition. And that way, being informed always gives you more power in any situation, and being trans you can sometimes end up pretty powerless, so it's a good thing to do. I hope those things are helpful. Certainly that first one, giving yourself time, is my main thing, and I wish I could have told myself that when I started, because I don't think I did that space and time to just develop, instead of expecting everything to be like that, because it will take time, and it should take time to naturally develop. Second part of the question, bless you, Jenny. Bless you for asking, because what's your favourite TV show? Now, I grew up watching Star Trek, The Next Generation specifically, and I don't feel like I would have lived without it as a teenager. It helped me survive. So this gives you an idea of how much I can obsess over shows, right? Geeky sci-fi comics person, grew up with Star Trek. I can be that obsessive about TV shows. However, there's one television show that I am scarily more obsessed with, more consumed by in my heart and my soul than any other. And people are often surprised when they learn what it is. And I think I've talked about it before. But I adore, to the bottom and height and with every breath of my being, I adore the Gilmore Girls. If you've ever seen it, here's my seasons 1, 2, 3, 4 and 5, although there were 7 seasons, box sets. I love it. For those of you who don't know what it's about, go to my personal channel, Tara Geek, on YouTube, and in my favourites, there's hundreds of wonderful clips from it. But the show is about Lorelai Gilmore, who, when she was 16 in 1984, got pregnant. She was the daughter of a well-to-do family in Hartford, Connecticut. She got pregnant and had the baby, then proceeded to, shortly after that, leave her family. They wound up, her and the baby wound up in the small town of Stars Hollow, not far from Hartford, where she built a life for them. 16 years later is where season one starts, and her daughter, also named Lorelai, because if guys can name their kids after themselves, why can't women too? And that, and she was hyped up on goofballs and drugs, you know, not drugs, but, you know, painkillers when she was in hospital giving birth. So she named her kid Lorelai, nicknamed Rory. And it's their life from when Rory's 16. And it's just their life, their loves. The teenager Rory is really smart and going finally in, getting into this really posh prep school, which means that Lorelai has to talk to her parents again properly for the first time in years for help paying. And it sounds really kind of hot, horribly wholesome and family values and kind of not interesting, right? It is very chick flicky, but it's quirky, it's kind of funny, and there's not a show in the world which is sharper, wittier. It's filled with references to either film or music or literature or God knows what, and you wouldn't believe it. It's snappiest, most heartfelt but intelligent dialogue and setup of any TV show. Those of you who are into comic books, and I know there are a few out there, former Daredevil writer Brian Michael Bendis loved the Gilmore Girls. I love it with all my heart and all my soul. And if it seemed too wholesome for you, trust me, it's not. It's the most alive thing I've ever come across on TV. And more than any other person or character in all of reality or fiction, I would like to be Lorelai Gilmore. Now go to my personal channel, Tara Geek, watch some of the clips and tell me that it's not marvellous. I'm sorry if this video is short this week. I'm not sure how long I've been talking. And I hope those three things about transition were helpful for you. Thank you for letting me gush and evangelise about a wonderful show that I bet some of you have dismissed, but don't. Trust me. Trust me, trust me, trust me. And you'll enjoy The Gilmore Girls. Now, I'm just going to see if I can start the DVD for you. Hold on. 1 second. Just got to start my DVD. Oh, sorry, I'm all achy. I've been at work today. I've been moving stacks of paper and dealing with hundreds of customers. And I should have timed this better, shouldn't I? But if this is just too rambly, we'll clip it off the end of the video. If not, bear with me as the DVD starts for my favourite show in all of the universe. Not even the world, the universe. Join me and watch The Gilmore Girls. Trust me, it's amazing. See you next week. Bye.